the Senate Standing Committee, Subcommittee on Human Services and Labor. I am Senator Roxanne Persaud, and I am the co-chair, and along with my colleague, Assemblymember Andrew Hevesy. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce the following members of the subcommittee from the Senate. Senator Jabari Brisport, Senator Jessica Scarsella-Spanton, Senator Jack Martins, and Senator Alexis Weick. I'll now turn it over to my co-chair, Assemblymember Hevesy.
Thank you, Senator, and good evening, everybody. The assembly members that are present are Assemblyman Harry Bronson, Assemblywoman Maritza DeVia, Assemblywoman Stephanie Zinnerman, Assemblyman Steve Stern, Assemblyman Sam Berger, also Assemblyman Brian D. Miller, and Assemblyman Brian Marr. Thank you.
Thank you. Our Senate One House is a robust proposal that includes 3.2% human services COLA. This COLA covers domestic violence workers, rape crisis counselors, independent living centers, New York State Supportive Housing Program, and others. And we are trying to restore prior year's legislative ads for DAP, NOAP, Welfare to Careers, and other critical programs. We're also trying to have $10 million in additional support for summer youth employment. As you know, every year we're fighting to increase the allocation for summer youth so that youth across the state could have access to jobs. The Senate also added Article 7 language to create a quarterly $80 DIAP allowance for income-eligible families with newborn through age two. And we've also included $500,000 to fund benefits cliff study to be undertaken by a fiscal cliff task force. So we are continuing the negotiations, and I will now turn it over to my colleague, Assemblymember Hevesy, for his comments.
Sure, thanks. Before I ask my colleagues to do their opening remarks, I'll do a few very quickly if I can, just to highlight some of the priorities that we see in the Assembly One House. So first, both the Senate and the Assembly add $220 million to the childcare workforce. We need to make that permanent for them, otherwise it's just still a bonus. But we are grateful to both houses for putting that in. I am grateful to the Senate for putting in facilitated enrollment. I'm assuming those conversations are going to continue going into the final budget. Very important for us that we keep the Assembly add of $2.8 million for infant toddler mental health. And then there are a number of bills that have passed both houses that are in the Assembly One House. There is a differential pay bill by Assemblymember Clark, also a cost estimation study by Assemblymember Clark, both of which are hugely important. I have a decoupling bill that was vetoed recently with a message to take it up in the budget, so we are. We hope that gets done. Some other items, they're smaller in size, but no less important. The Assembly adds $5 million for runaway and homeless youth. I think that's crucially important considering where we are today. We look to thank the Senate for their addition of $5 million to the After School Coordinating Council. The YMCAs, our friends at the YMCAs, are asking for $5 million, and I think they should get it. And then here's two that I really want to highlight. Child advocacy centers. Now, we made sure that the federal funding, which we were afraid was going to run out, is going to be restored, but those child advocacy centers could use another $5 million. They'll be pushing for that. And then here's another big one, settlement houses. We have not increased money for settlement houses in over a decade, and they have been suffering, and they are on the front lines of every social service, so that's crucially important. Just a couple more, forgive me, for Raise the Age, the Assembly put in $50 million. For a fund that'll be crucially important, and we need to allow New York City to get Raise the Age funds. The fact that we still have a Cuomo de Blasio fight preventing some of our kids getting that money is just outrageous. And let me end here on this one. The 65-35 reimbursement for counties. I'm not going to get into it, but this is always the top of our list. It's crucially important. And we hope that while in the past years both the Senate and the Assembly have pushed for it, we hope that this is the final year that we get that done. And that's all I have, but thank you, Senator. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
You're welcome. So again, thank you for being here. The Senate and the Assembly each designate a secretary for the purpose of taking minutes. You see them behind us. And the Assembly's designee is Lauren Ryan. And the Senate's designee is Dennis Weekly, both of them behind us. I just want to remind all of you the agencies that fall on this table, the Department of Civil Service, Office of Employee Relations, Division of Human Rights, Workers' Compensation Board, Office of Welfare Inspector General, Office of Temporary and Disability Assistance, Department of Labor, Office of Children and Family Services, Division of Veterans Services, Public Employees Relations Board. I will now turn it over to the Assembly for additional remarks.
Thank you. Let me start with Assemblymember Bronson.
Thank you, Co-Chair Basad, and have a seat. I look forward to working with my colleagues in the Assembly and the Senate as we promote policies in the labor area that will improve the lives of job seekers, workers, and families all across New York State. As we work through this budget, we must remember that budgets truly are a statement of our priorities. As we address policies and funding issues, I ask each of us to consider and to put the vitally important objective of social, racial, and economic justice forward. We must ensure that we move toward a more equitable, inclusive, and just economy as well as workforces. Our policies and financial investments must move people who have been on the economic and workforce sidelines for far too long into the workforces and into our economy as full participants. To meet that objective, we must fully fund community initiatives like Workforce Development Institute, the various Cornell workforce and worker programs, workforce development programs like the Multi-Craft Apprenticeship Preparation Program that prepares historically disadvantaged young men and women of color for viable career in the construction trades. Similarly, we should continue our investment in the summer youth employment programs. And although this next item is really at the taxation table, we must include the Work Opportunity Tax Credit, which will assist in uplifting historically disadvantaged individuals and communities, as well as help combat our workforce shortages throughout many industries. This tax credit is very similar to the existing federal Work Opportunity Tax Credit. We have a tremendous opportunity as we are facing a worker shortage while simultaneously have emerging industries and workforces, especially in upstate New York, related to the green chip industries, tech hub designation, and battery innovation, as well as the transition from fossil industry to a renewable, sustainable energy industry. Through this budget, let us invest wisely with the intention of truly creating opportunities for all New Yorkers. In addition, in this budget, we need to increase the short-term disability leave benefits. Getting TDI benefit up is a priority since it has been capped at a mere $170 per week since 1989. And doing that increase, we need to make sure the increase is for the entire 26-week period of a disability leave. And we need to make sure that we control the cost to the employee's share of this benefit. In addition, unemployment insurance benefits is very important as we face this budget year. It has been frozen since 2019 at levels of $504 per week because of the state's debt with the federal UI trust. So in this budget, we must address the federal unemployment insurance debt. And in so doing, then we need to move the weekly benefit up to a more reasonable level. Those are just a handful of the items that we need to take care of in the area of labor, but I look forward again to working with all my colleagues so that we have a fair, a just budget. Thank you.
Chair DeVia.
Good evening, everyone. It's the green button. I usually don't speak at these hearings because my colleagues, of course, have it. They sort of give us the rundown of the entire budget. But I just wanted to mention, I was so very happy and elated about the assembly, including $200 million to establish the increasing nutrition support for parental and infant residency INSPIRE program to provide cash assistance to low-income households during the last 3 months of pregnancy and through the first years of child's life. And as we all know that communities that are of low income and mothers that are not getting the care that they need are the ones to suffer the consequences. So this is great for infant, you know, the infant mortality issues that we are having. Furthermore, I wanted to also announce the assembly provides $145 million to establish a supplemental basic grant for public assistance intended to address the insufficient of benefits that have not been adjusted since 2011. This would include covering the local shares of safety net costs and this increase through county fiscal year 2024. So I just wanted to announce that and all of the work that all of the people that are on this dais, the work that they put in makes this possible. So when we talk about inequality, this is where it starts and this is where it ends. Thank you.
Senator Martins.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, thank you to Senator Persaud and to Assemblyman Hevesy for their work chairing this conference committee. I come at this issue more from a labor standpoint, so I want to congratulate both houses on reaching consensus when it comes to requiring PLAs for SUNY projects. It's very important when we go at this issue that we prioritize employment through PLAs, and PLAs ensure that the work is done by New Yorkers and that those wages not only go to the benefit of their families, but to the community at large. We talk about the multiplier effect when it comes to payment of wages, but there is no surer way of making sure that wages stay in New York than to use PLAs, union labor, and make sure that those wages are then spent in local communities, groceries, hardware stores, and community events. It's a proven fact, and we should prioritize that going forward. I'm glad to see that we have. You know, I start with the premise that there is dignity in work. And so anything we do that prioritizes that fact, the ability for people to earn a living, the ability of those people then to actually provide for their families. So I do want to congratulate the efforts here. I am a little disappointed that we weren't able to address the debt on the UI benefit, and we weren't able to address that issue because by addressing that issue, we would have had the ability to increase and properly bring UI benefits to so many people who are unemployed and are still stuck at $504. We have the ability to do that. We certainly, with the numbers that we're talking about in this budget, had the ability to pick up that $250 million. I wish we had prioritized that. Perhaps that's something that we can consider going forward. And just lastly, and I made this point in our one house, and I'll make the point again, I think we had a unique opportunity this year to do something far more meaningful when it came to Tier 6. We had the opportunity to go at Tier 6 more aggressively. I think there were projections in terms of savings going forward when Tier 6 was enacted back in 2012. I don't see that those projections were realized. And so as we hear from our public workforce, be they members of our own staffs, CSEA, teachers, or across the state, there's one thing they've asked us to do is to address Tier 6 holistically. And frankly, if we're going to bring this budget to $246 billion, I think we had the opportunity to be a lot more aggressive on that front and really provide relief. There isn't a group out there that has not told us that they are having a hard time recruiting and retaining talented workforce for all of us, whether it's on a state or local level, whether it's in our schools or otherwise. We had the opportunity to do that, so I have to point out Certainly one of my regrets and disappointments is that we haven't been able to reach consensus on that, and I would hope that we can continue to work on that as we go forward. With that, thank you.
Good afternoon. I want to thank Chair Passad, Chair Hevesy, my colleagues in the Senate and the Assembly for really centering New Yorkers' humanity and taking care of the most vulnerable amongst us, our elders, our youth, people with disabilities, and of course those who are formerly incarcerated. As a member of the Labor Committee and of course the lifelong workforce development champion, I am happy to see that we are really focusing on preparing people for work, training people for work, and supporting workers through COLA increases and other benefits to make sure that the next generation of workers are able to stay in New York, afford New York, enjoy New York, and pass on their wealth to the next generation. I certainly also want to center those that are 62 years of age or older who are now taking care of their grandchildren. And so I'm happy to see the restoration of the kinship care program at 1.9 million and of course the kinship navigator program. Those are just essential, especially when you think about those who have worked all their lives and are now on a fixed income and they have additional mouths to feed. So that restoration is very important. I just want to lift up, as somebody who works very hard in my district to create career pathways for our children, that Youth Build and An Opportunity for Better Tomorrow are both in the program and highlighted as well. And I think I'll just round off with just our ability to provide the very best start for our young people from the time that they are born and into preschool. Having money in the budget for youth development programs and after-school programs is essential to not only the safety in our community, but their development into fully capable New York. So again, I want to thank each and every one of my colleagues, and let's continue to do the best that we can for all New Yorkers.
Thank you. Senator Wyke?
Thank you, Chair. As ranker on civil service, we sat through two public hearings this past fall, and after listening to the really great quality comments that came from a lot of the agencies who showed up, it seems like this budget ignores that. It's small tweaks to Tier 6 when they made it very, very clear that there were a lot of different opportunities that we could have had to really increase and grow our public employee sector or maintain those individuals who are there who are leaving for other opportunities. So I'm really disappointed to see that there's only a small amount of tweaking done to Tier 6. So this is a really good opportunity where we could have made Tier 6 better or repealed it entirely and tried again. And I think we're missing out on a really great opportunity to at a critical time in the state where we have such a shortage of employees. I'm disappointed in that section, but thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you for affording me the opportunity to speak today on behalf of the Assembly Minority Conference. Human service workers and child care providers continue to play an important role helping New Yorkers in their daily lives. The Assembly Minority Conference continues to advocate for responsible spending that will help those in need. The Minority Conference has proposed a comprehensive child care legislative package. We believe this three-pronged approach, including tax credits, provider support, and expanded family options for child care, are key to fixing child care in New York State and is better use of the state's funds and would serve the people of the state. As New Yorkers continue to struggle with rising costs, the governor and the majorities continue to propose giving New York City $2.4 billion for costs associated with the migrant crisis. The federal government needs to cover this cost. We cannot continue to shoulder these exuberant costs indefinitely, and the state must recognize that it needs to end these expenses and instead focus on the taxpayers who are footing the bill by addressing the affordability crisis and keeping New Yorkers safe. Small businesses make up over 90% of employees in New York State. Saddling them with $7.5 billion in outstanding unemployment insurance trust fund debt from 2020 is just unfair. The Minority Conference called for the use of pandemic relief funds to pay off this portion of this debt, so that small businesses were and are not continued to be crushed by increased unemployment taxes. These are the same businesses whose already thin margins were corroded by the pandemic. Our conference is proposing to lessen the burden on small businesses by providing $500 million to cover the interest assessment surcharge cost. Lastly, while we appreciate that both majorities put in funding for the Veterans Advising Program that was taken out by the governor, the Assembly Minority Conference believes it is very important to fund specific veterans programs, including employment training programs like helmets, the hard hats, and legal service programs like New York City Justice Project, along with others that the governor has cut from her budget. As we continue to negotiate the budget, which will be one of the most important budget processes we ever partake in, we should ensure that the negotiations are transparent, open to the public, and negotiated on a five-way basis. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity. While I echo my colleague and the Minority Conference's positions, I also want to very much say that we appreciate what Senator Prasad brought up, which is the Fiscal Cliff Task Force, which was a true bipartisan effort between chairs and rankers of the Social Services Committee and the Senate and the Assembly to really identify some of those shortfalls and see if we can address them. I also want to say, for spearheading the 6535 reimbursement, you're not the only one. I enjoy hearing you say that. I know that every single dollar given to our counties makes a real meaningful difference in people's lives. So that is something that we really ought to keep an eye on and hopefully see through the finish line, as well as the summer youth employment funding. I do want to say, though, when it comes to the 3.2% COLA, there is language that is potentially harmful, according to many of the local providers. And while we really want to make sure that these funds go directly to the employees, that's also the strategy for the $4,000 direct support wage enhancement. And it's a bit of catch up and keep up. And that's kind of how it's been relayed to me by those that are on the ground. And I know that's going to be covered in mental health, but I know it's also brought up here today. And when you see inflation going up 30% and the COLA over that same decade is 10.5%, that's why we really need both. So just wanted to also echo that. And when we say tier six, also five and six. And that's about all. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblymember. I'm going to take chairman's privilege, and I'm only going to use 30 seconds of your time, but I already used 10. I just, for those of you who are looking particularly at the human services budget, take a look at how many of these programs we are trying to make up for bad budgeting over the last decade. I don't want to sound like a broken record, but there was a forced austerity, absolutely unnecessary, and whether it's Tier 6, 6535, raise the age, a COLA, all of it, it's because we were budgeting terribly before. We got to make up a lot of lost ground, but I only say this in an effort to never let that happen again. Thank you for allowing me to say that.
Again, thank you, everyone. As you know, most budget items are still open, and we will... Okay, most budget items are still open and the negotiations continue. I would like again to thank everyone for coming and the Senate, and we look forward to continuing working with the Assembly and the Executive to ensure that we have a budget that we can be proud of.
Thank you to
our staff, and thank you to all of you for being here with us this afternoon. Have a great evening. We are adjourned.